Okay. Hello everyone, and thanks for to invite me for this one. Do you hear me well? No? Okay. Good. So first I start with some motivation, then we will go to math. Okay. So we have lots of big networks nowadays. So these are some of the examples that I will mention. Like for example, for social networks, these networks that we are aware of them, like 10 to the 9 nodes. Biological network, like brain connectome network, these are especially important, to understand the brain functions. Computer networks, like internet IP or web graph, potentially we can have 2 to the 33 nodes because the length of the IP is 32 bits. And like transportation networks, even at Google Maps, we have graphs that they have lots of nodes. Like here, even the smallest one is 10 to the 8. Others are much bigger. And we need to solve lots of natural problems on this thing. For example, we want to find botnets or spam detection on computer networks. You may want to do community detection in social networks. You may want to solve reachability or distance between transportation networks or summarization, sparsification, and visualization in biological networks. How can we solve them? The main way to solve them is essentially these traditional and very basic optimization problems like matching, vertex cover, set cover, hitting set, among denser subgraph, among other problems. So we need to solve them. Now, to understand, these problems better, the complexity of this, we need to have some simple model. But first, we need to understand a little bit more about the restrictions. For this big data, often we have partial access to manipulate this data. So this partial access may come because this data are stored in a relatively slow, huge external hard drive. Or it might be the case that they are in some network cloud and we don't have a space to download them all. Or it might be the case that this data are coming too fast and it's too much to save them or store them. Like in internet routers, the one that we had it while I was at AT&T, that was a big problem there. Also, there is another thing that the potential users of this big data may not have essentially supercomputers, and by supercomputers I mean clusters of computers like the infrastructure that Google has. For example, it might be a cell phone user who may want to verify blockchain. Blockchain is like a set of all Bitcoin transactions. And if you want to really do some Bitcoin transaction, you need to check this one or verify that this guy is a valid seller of Bitcoins. Or there might be some other case, for example, some rare event happens and you have the data all over the place and they are not indexed for this thing, like the data at Google indexed for the purpose of search. But you may have data from different things, like from the cameras, maybe from social media, social networks. This example that we had it and we wanted to find, for example, the suspects. And there are lots of data from lots of places, not indexed for this purpose, but still we need to get meaningful information, for example, a person who is working on the case. Or it might be the case, like for internet providers, that they need some statistical data. Again, this was some examples that we had it at AT&T, that there were lots of data that were going through the network and we want to understand some understanding about the statistics of the packets that are going through the network. So here we consider a very simple and very fundamental model here. So we are assuming that the data arrive in a natural order which is outside of the algorithm's control. And we have a space to only essentially keep a sketch or summary of the data. The algorithm can read this big data once or maybe just a constant number of times. This model itself is very appropriate for something like temporally dynamic data, like online social networks or Bitcoin transaction or internet routers. So that's the perfect model for that. But actually, this one is more important because, if I have time, I will mention at the end. So I wanted to essentially, we had some big networks and I wanted to work with them. And of course, I'm not that much, adapt to using complicated OS or something like this. I want to have like a simple structure. And the simple structure was this, my laptop and like a hard drive, like external hard drive, which is connected to that. And I wanted to read this data and get some meaningful information out of it. So for a person, or like you can just do the same thing for a cell phone, that you want to just read the big data, maybe from cloud, maybe from hard drive or something like this, and get some important information out of it. And this was exactly the model that you can consider it. So as a byproduct of this model, we have this good property. Not only that, also if you want to have the Google's capability and you want to do, for example, some information on the big network, the algorithm that we are designing here are often very smart sampling or hashing algorithm, because the model is very basic. We cannot do that much complicated stuff. So we need to do some simple stuff. And at the same time, this simple stuff can be easily implemented in MapReduce or other things like Priggle, the one that handles graphs. You can implement them very well and easily on them. So even you can solve the problem using a Google infrastructure, for example, or Facebook data infrastructures. So that's essentially best of all worlds, if we can design good algorithm. So this is the exact model. We are assuming, the rest of the talk, that the edges are coming one by one. We are seeing each edge once means that if it is gone, then we cannot, come back to it. And the space should be sublinear in the size of the input. That's important because the data is huge. And we try to analyze time to process each edge, which is called the update time or accuracy of the answer, among other goals that we have it. So the variations that we have in the model, it would be one pass or a small number of paths here. For the sake of simplicity, in this talk, we just consider one path. And more interesting thing is the insertion only, that the edges will be inserted, or the elements will be just inserted, versus the case that the edges can be added or deleted. That's actually, it is called dynamic case, and there are very good motivations for that. I will come back to it. Okay, so far everything was good if we could design good algorithms. However, the bad news is that streaming is often hard. What's the meaning of that? It means that if you want to go sublinear in n, the number of inputs, the number of nodes, essentially the life is very difficult. We cannot even keep this information that whether we have seen this edge before or not. We cannot even see whether this vertex we have seen it or not. And some technique that the people may use it in other areas of algorithm design, like randomization, does not help. Indeed, we can prove via communication complexity with no condition, p not equal to np. We can prove that for lots of problems, you cannot go below n, even with randomization. So what can we do? We need to relax, essentially, some of the constraints. One relaxation that has been done before, it is called semi-streaming. That was there actually for some time. They are trying to get sublinear in M, the number of edges, but still linear in N, the number of vertices. That's a nice way in terms of theoretical work. However, as I have mentioned before, the nodes that we have in the graph, these big networks, are quite large, 10 to the 9 or something. So sublinear, linear in N is still not good. So we need to get some ideas from the practice. And that's this one. Let's make some assumptions about the input. And this should be some real world assumption that we can make about the input. And we call it the promised streaming model. It means that we know that this data stream that comes has some certain properties. Then we want to get sublinear in N, or strictly streaming algorithms. So really we want to get a smaller space. And by the way, this sublinear in N, the space and the time are usually proportional to each other. So if you can get a good space, you can also get good time as well, update time. So that's essentially the goal. And this goal actually comes from lots of practical applications that I have seen. For example, some of them at AT&T that we were working with big data. Like, often we know that the data structure, the graph or the input that you will get it, has some restrictions or assumptions. And based on that, you should design some nice algorithms. For example, you may know that the edge density or graph structure of the input. You may know that the real massive graphs are not too dense, for example. Or you may have some assumption on the cost or size of the solution. Means that, okay, the graph, like maybe the social network is huge, but the like a terrorist cell that you try to find is a small one, and it's much smaller than the size of the graph. So these are some of the examples that we have done it. I mean, recently, for example, we showed that if the input graph is planar or bounded degenerate graph, bounded degenerate, I mean, here, say, almost bounded average degree, I don't define it here. Then in this case, I mean, you can get, for example, for a matching problem or a few other problems, we could get sublinear in N, like N to the 2/3 essentially. And I think the belief is that maybe a square root of N also you can do that. And that's very important. That was also very impressive to some people that work in the area. So if you know that the graph is planar, then you can do much better. Or you may assume that, I mean, the edges that are coming from some distributions or from in some random order or some distribution. Then you can do much better than just the worst case. And last but not least are the parameterized streaming, which is essentially the topic of this talk. And there, I mean, we are assuming that, again, the cost or size of the solution is much smaller than N. And that's essentially motivated by fixed parameter tractability. And of course, we can consider combinations of all above, and we are currently considering some of them, and that some of the future work that can be done here. Okay, so parameterized streaming. Here we want to do essentially a streaming with a space which is a function of k, the solution size, which can be much smaller than n, the number of vertices. More precisely, I mean, we want to get f of k, the solution size. K is essentially the solution size, times polylog n. And polylog n, as often, I mean, we cannot avoid it, so that will be there. And now, if you compare that one essentially with fixed parameter tractability, in fixed parameter tractability, if k is the size of solution, the naive algorithms have running time like exponentially in n, or maybe a little bit better, n to the k. But here, we want to get f of k times poly n. And here we want to get f of k times polylog n in terms of space. So any questions so far?
I mean, you can also write f of k plus polylog n.
Yeah, that you can also do that, actually. But I mean, generally we have the, I mean, multiplications. But I mean, maybe for some problem, I mean, that reduction, you need to be careful. I'm not so sure that here we can have f of k. Here we can have f of k plus poly n. But here I'm not so sure that you can get it for all things, at least to be seen, essentially. So here I want to start with the vertex cover. And this is a famous NPR problem. But actually, the approach is much more general and works for a framework of problems. And I will mention briefly at the end. Okay, so we need to talk about kernelization. I mean, lots of you probably know about the kernelization, but I just repeat for those that they may not know or the exact definition. So here, if you have a graph G, and for a problem P, we try to get another graph G prime, which is in some sense the sketch of G. Here, we want to get the size of this graph be proportional to the K, the size of the problem on G. And then any solution that you have in G has a correspondence in G prime and vice versa. And essentially, we know that FP, like kernelization somehow is as strong as fixed parameter tractability. Namely, we know any problem which is FPT has also a kernelization solution. But the kernelization might not have polynomial time. It is f of k, but f of k might be exponential. Of course, I mean, when we get the polynomial in k, that would be the best. But even exponential would be good. And note that when we get the kernelization, then parameterized algorithm would be also easy, because you know that this graph G prime has poly k solution. So even if you do exponential time search on it, still you have a very good running time. Like, good means f of k running time. Good. Now let's go do kernelization on graph streams. So the vertex cover, we want to find a set of vertices like here, such that every edge has at least one vertex in S. So let's do a very simple algorithm for the case that edges will be inserted. So here we want to maintain a matching M greedily. So what's the meaning of that? It means that when the edges are coming one by one, if we can add them, if none of the endpoints appear before, you will just add it to the matching that you will keep to the M, as well as the graph G prime, which is the kernel essentially. Now, if one of the endpoints of this new edge has appeared before, then you will see that endpoint, what is the degree of that. If the degree is less than k, then you will add this one, this edge, to the graph G prime. And if the, like, that vertex has more than k, already more than k neighbors, then you just forget about that edge. And that's it, essentially. So that's a simple algorithm to give you some ideas about the this case. Now, two observations is important here. First, we know that if we know the size of the vertex cover is k, by the way, here we are assuming that you know what would be the size of the vertex cover at the would be at most k, and you know k, but later you can relax this one with a more complicated algorithm. Then you know that the size of the matching cannot be more than k, because for each edge you need to have at least one vertex cover. More importantly, you know that if a vertex has degree greater than k, then that vertex should be in the vertex cover. Why? Because if it is not the case, then all the neighbors should be there, and that would be at least k plus 1, which is essentially contradiction. So essentially, this is the idea that why this algorithm works, and that any time you can consider this graph G prime, the matching plus some other edges, and on this graph you can do, for example, a fixed parameter algorithm, or you can do an approximation algorithm and get a solution for vertex cover in the original graph. Why? Because in a sense, for low degree vertices we will keep all edges. For high degree vertices, we are keeping enough edges such that we can cover, essentially construct a vertex cover. But let's go and see what about the space. So here we have at most k edges in the matching, 2k nodes as a total in the matching, and for each of them we will keep at most k edges. So the total space would be essentially 2k times k would be 2 to the k to the 2. And interestingly, here we can also prove that, again, using communication complexity under no condition, like p not equal to np or other things, that we cannot do anything better than k to the 2 for finding a vertex cover or matching, among other problems. So we get a tight result here for the insertion case. Of course, that was a simple but good exercise. Now, the most interesting case would be the dynamic graph case, in which the edges can be inserted or deleted. Means they can be friend or unfriend. For example, if you want to take it in Facebook, it would be friend and unfriend in Facebook. However, it has much more meaning here. So by deletion, you can consider that, I mean, the edges or the elements, for example, for a router, really doesn't matter that these packets that went through that yesterday. So these are the data, these are not very relevant to the router now. Maybe 1 hour ago even, it is not relevant. It means that some of the edges may have some timestamp, and if you are passing that certain threshold of time, then you don't care about them. In this case, it means that these edges or these elements will be deleted from the data structure. So here, by delete means not necessarily delete by unfriend, but means that essentially after some threshold of time, then it will be irrelevant to our data structure. It means that those edges will be deleted then, or the elements will be deleted. Now this algorithm that I mentioned, I mean, it does not work essentially for the case that we have deletions. Why? Because here we are using the fact that at all time we have a maximal matching. And this maximal matching, if you delete one of the edges, then it will be not maximal, because you might be able to essentially find some kind of augmenting path, but we don't have the info to update this augmenting path because we lost those edges, and or we forgot those edges. So this one cannot be done easily. Indeed, this is a very, it was a very hard problem. And first, we had a quite complicated approach in this SODA paper previous year. Then we could simplify it. I will mention the simplification. That's quite nice algorithm and very clean algorithm. And but both of them were under this condition that the vertex cover at all time would be at mouse k. So all the k would be the max of vertex cover over all input, like means insertion and deletion. An exciting case would be something like that. That when I talk with some people in the field, they will say, oh, there should be some lower bound for that. You cannot do anything. The interesting thing would be that case, that k is really the maximum size at the end. It means that you may start with some small graph, then you may put lots of noise, make it even a complete graph. The vertex cover or matching can go become very large. And then you delete all of them. And then at the end, you may just have the original edges. And still you want to get a good running time which is proportional to size of this and not size of the middle guys. As I mentioned, it was, I mean, quite obvious to some people that, yeah, you cannot do anything essentially. But indeed, we tried to prove the lower bound. We couldn't because there was an algorithm. And I will mention the ideas of the algorithm hopefully at the end of the talk. So you can do that, and that's this SODA 2016 paper. So before that, I need to say two important data structures actually for this streaming algorithm. If you know them, you can start actually working with these data streams. These are very nice and simple data structures. One is called the k-sparse recovery. So what is the k-sparse recovery? So here we have a data structure which accepts insertion and deletions of at most k at most like n elements. And at any time, if the number of elements is less than k, then you can output them all. But if it is more than k, it does not have any guarantee. So one, and there is a deterministic construction to do that, which is k poly log n space. And you may just think about it. I mean, what would be like one sparse recovery data structure? Any guess? I mean, that would be very simple, actually. If you just consider the XORs. So when you just have a data structure that just XORs the elements. So if the number of elements is 1, and by the way, we can count how many elements are in our data structure because we can insert and delete, and we will count how many data, like elements in our data structure. If it is 1, it means that the element itself, we can report it. But if it is more than 1, then does not have any guarantee. But at the same, this is also some, I mean, the same idea that has been used in network coding, for example. And I mean, more than k, that's also not that hard. Essentially, you can have some kind of system of linear equations over some data field. And if it is less than k, then they will be independent vectors. You can find the exact elements. If it is more than k, you have just some linear combinations of them, and we cannot get the elements. So the other one, which is also interesting, the k-sampler. The same input. Now this is somewhat complementary of the previous case. If the number of elements is more than k, then we can essentially provide a sample of size k from these elements, from these n elements. But if it is less than k, we don't have any guarantee. Again, here we have k poly log space to construct that. But this algorithm is randomized. Actually, big open problem here is that can we somehow de-randomize it? I mean, with some good definition of here we have in some sense randomization. But I mean, maybe still we can de-randomize it like this, like hashing type of things that we can do some de-randomization here. So that would be a nice problem. So we don't know here, essentially, can we de-randomize it or not? It's a big open problem in the streaming algorithms. Okay, now let's go to our algorithm. So what do we do for vertex cover, essentially? So the data structure for promised algorithm that we have is this one. So for each of high degree vertices, we will, by the way, so we are here, we are assuming that we have k-sparse recovery as well as k-sampler. If the number of elements is greater than k, we have a sample of size k. If it is less than k, we have all of them. Now, for each of these high degree nodes, we will keep the edges, the neighboring edges of that vertex. And for the low degree vertices, we will keep all the edges in a set L. So let's see an example here. So, and this is essentially the simplified algorithm that I have mentioned. So say the endpoints have degree less than k. So you just add the edges. So the edges are L, the black ones are in L. So you will add them essentially in L, and k is 3 here. So at some point, the degree of a vertex becomes essentially k. Then in this case, you will just delete all these edges from L, and then you will add them to a k-sparse recovery as well as k-sampler data structure. And you will put a timestamp on this k-sparse recovery. That's very important. This timestamp was the main thing that our first algorithm in SODA was quite complicated. Because, I mean, this, we need to somehow partition the edges between this L and this k-sparse recovery. And the idea is that, I mean, when we are adding these edges to this k-sparse recovery things, we don't have access to edges to see if we have added this edge to this data structure. We cannot later inquiry that whether we have added this edge to this data structure or not, because it has only some linear combinations of those things. And it is important that when you add to some k-sparse recovery structure, you don't delete it from another one. That's essentially the reason that this timestamp would be very important. So you will put a timestamp here such that you make sure that you will add it to which data structure. No, you will repeat it. This vertex becomes a degree k. You will delete everything. Now, if you will add an edge between one vertex that has a vertex like a k-sparse recovery and the one that does not have it, you will just add it to that. But if both of the endpoints have it, then you will add it to the one that has a smaller timestamp. And that's essentially for insertion. Now for the deletion, you are doing the reverse of that. If you delete an edge which is in L, you will just delete it from L. That's easy. And if one of the endpoints has k-sparse recovery, then you will just delete it from that k-sparse recovery. However, if both endpoints have k-sparse recovery, then you will delete it from the one that has the lowest timestamp. That's the important one, essentially. And if at some point the size of the sparse recovery becomes less than k, again, we will have some count of the number of edges there, then you will just delete that k-sparse recovery as well as this k-sampler and just retrieve all the edges, because you can do that because the number of edges is less than k, and then you will add them to L. And that's it. That's the whole algorithm, essentially. That's a simplified algorithm. And why does it work? I mean, it can be essentially somehow formalized, not hard, essentially. For high degree vertices, again, we will keep enough edges. And for low degree vertices, we will keep all L. And by the way, it is important that here, the only randomization, so during the course of the algorithm, we don't use any randomization, except for the case that you want to create this graph G prime, the kernel one at the end. In that case, to get this K edges, such that we can create this graph, then you need to use the K samplers to, you can get some sample of size k. And here, essentially, that's the idea, I mean, for the algorithm. And why we have, what is the space that we have? We know that we have k samplers, essentially. Each of them is, each sampler is corresponding to high degree vertex that should be in the vertex cover. It would be at most k of them because of the promise that is given to us at any time. the size of the vertex cover, and each of them use k poly log n. So it would be k to the 2 poly log the total space for k sparse recovery as well as k sampler. And what about the edges in L? We know that each vertex in L can cover at most k edges. Otherwise, we have created essentially a vertex recovery for that. So there, and the size of the vertex cover is at most k. So the total number of edges in L would be k times k, would be k to the 2. That would be k to the 2 polylog. The total thing, that that's the best that we could do it essentially up to polylog factor. And of course, that's a very simple algorithm to implement. Now let me just mention the idea of the how can we do that magic one when the k is the size at the end. So here you need to do a little bit, more sophisticated vertex sampling, essentially instead of edge sampling that we have done it here. So we will hash each vertex to a number in 1 to k. That we will do it before the running time of the algorithm. Now, in the running of the algorithm, for each pair of numbers ij that comes between 1 to k and 1 to k, for each of these essentially pairs, we maintain a data structure that keeps at least one edge of these pairs essentially. So if it's more than one, we just insert it essentially to this data structure, like k-sparse recovery things. And for each pair, for example, here, as you can see here, we only keep these edges. The rest, we don't keep it. Now, and actually to get this, the high probability, you are doing this one log k times. But we can essentially prove this theorem, which is actually nice. I mean, it's not very hard, but it's cute, the proof. That assuming the size of the vertex cover is k at the end, or the matching size k at the end, then g prime and g have the same set of the vertex cover and the same size vertex cover with high probability. Essentially, we are done, because at the end, then we will just consider these two graphs, we will retrieve some samples, and then we can solve that. I mean, the running time that I have mentioned, it has k to the 2 pairs, and for each of them, if you use a k-sparse recovery, it would be k to the 3 polylog, but you can also, shave off this 3 and make it 2, essentially. You can do k to the 2 polylog, and that's the best that you can hope. This actually works for a general set of problems, not just this one. Essentially, for any problem or property which is preserved under vertex contraction. Vertex contraction means that essentially if you contract two vertices into one vertex, the property will be kept essentially if the original graph had it. And these are the examples that you can see it. I don't repeat them. So I don't have that much time. I just want to say, we have implemented actually some of these algorithms using this big graphs, and we could get some good results out of it, like for this brain graphs, with this like 2 billion edges, 34 millions, we could solve some of them, and we could get in terms of memory, very reasonable memory, and time, reasonable time. And some of them, even if you want to read this data, it takes maybe 25 minutes to just go through this data, or like 1 hour, 40 minutes if you want to sort these edges. So I don't go through much more details. So these algorithms that I have mentioned are some of them actually is available on this Big D&D website that we have it. We try to find more data sets and refer to those who are providing this data to us, such that we have a big data of essentially dynamic networks. And so some of them problems, essentially. I think this was just the start, not the end. We started it like maybe 1.5 years, 2 years ago. And still, there might be much more relation between parameterized algorithms and vertex cover and streaming algorithm, especially kernelization, because that's the same concept, a sketch there and parameterized algorithm as well as streaming algorithms. So you may want to think about other problems that we can, that kernelization exists, can we use it here or vice versa. Here, of course, one idea that we had it for this promised one or parameterized one is essentially understanding better the real world. So in the real world, if there are these big problems, we need to solve them, and we need to use any property or any promise that real world is giving to us. So it would be better if we can design the algorithms for that. I mean, of course, it would be good to get some kind of algorithmic frameworks, meta algorithm here, as I mentioned, it's not just working for vertex cover, works for like all vertex contraction or something like this. So it would be good always to provide a general setting. That's it, essentially. Yeah, I mean, that would be a good thing. I mean, we didn't. I mean, these are the main thing that we had currently exist, essentially. This is a state of the art, as far as I know. And I think if you parameterize with different things, which makes sense, because I think if you know that the graph has, or the network has this property, then you want to understand the other property of that. It makes complete sense to assume that and get a better things. And here, as I mentioned, here we get k to the 2. If the size is k small, we can get very good things. So all of them are still open. And that was, as I mentioned, just the introduction. It's not a complete work at all. Just the beginning. Yeah?
Discussion about how hardware is going to change in terms of memory. Would that change the motivation? In the next few years, I expect there to be, you can hold everything in memory. The hardware guys talk like that.
At the same time, the network probably becomes bigger and bigger. So, and I mean, as I mentioned, is these things even, I mean, if you want to, this would be a simple thing that is currently, I mean, the algorithms are very simple, this kind of, I want to give a good credit also to the algorithm, because these algorithms are very smart algorithms. By just sampling, some nice way of sampling, you can get good properties. So they will find some other application somewhere, essentially. The fast algorithm will be useful anyhow.
Any other questions? Okay, let's thank the speaker again.